Now, as you may know, the Byrds are at Liverpool Empire this Friday night on a package with Farron's Flamingos and the Undertakers. Now, to be honest, this lineup of the Byrds doesn't include Roger McGuinn, David Crosby, Chris Hillman or Gene Clark. But it does include the Byrds' original drummer Michael Clark and Skip Battin, who was with the Byrds from 1969 to 1973, along with two new members, Jerry Sawne and Terry Rogers. Now, I met up with them at their soundcheck before a concert at Preston Guildhall, and I must say that I was very impressed with them. I spoke to both Michael Clark and Skip Battin for On the Beat. Michael Clark was the original drummer with the Byrds, and I'd heard that he was chosen for the Byrds in 1964 because of his long hair and his good looks. In fact, he looked rather like Brian Jones of the Rolling Stones, rather than his playing ability. In fact, it's been said that when Michael Clark joined the Byrds, he couldn't even play the drums at all.
That's a wives' tale, because yes, I played for many years, not in any popular bands or anything, but, you know, small bands. I mean, we were young then. Boy, I had never played on a large stage before, you know. Small, teeny, teeny club, you know.
Well, it's interesting to hear you say all this, because it's pretty well contradicting what David Crosby wrote in his autobiography.
David Crosby is, in my opinion, I'm not going to say anything bad about him.
But you'd like to. What he writes about isn't really true.
No, he's a lying fool.
What about Mr. Tambourine Man? Is it true that the Byrds weren't really playing in that session?
Yeah, David didn't play on it. Roger was the only person that played on that. David sang on it. He didn't play because he wasn't good enough. And Gene and I were gone. We were in San Francisco at the time, and they were recording it in L.A. You're getting a second scoop on this now. You know, we had a lot of good guys on there. Glenn Campbell, James Burton, Jerry Cole, Hal Blaine, all the, you know, happening L.A. studio guys. We were on the backside, however, and we also did everything else from there on out.
First of all, it interests me that Bob Dylan's version has several verses in it, and it's just one on the record.
We do, in our show, two extra verses. It's a brilliant piece of poetry. It was time for him to come into his own. He was a wonderful poet, and Peter, Paul and Mary did several of his songs, you know, Blowing in the Wind and all of that, right? Peter, Paul and Mary. When we did Tambourine Man, you know, basically it put him on the map. So what we did was put poetry to music.
Now, when that record first came out, great as it was, a lot of people in Liverpool in particular said, ah, they've taken the Searchers sound.
Oh, the Searchers sound. We always loved the Searchers, I'll tell you that. We all sounded pretty much alike, but we weren't trying to sound like the Searchers. It's a nice compliment as far as I'm concerned. I'd take the compliment well.
Hey, Mr. Tambourine Man, play a song for me.
And what about all the criticism that happened in America of Mr. Tambourine Man and 8 Miles High, that they were said to be drug songs?
Mr. Tambourine Man had absolutely nothing to do with drugs, and 8 Miles High had nothing to do with drugs. 8 Miles High was written as we were flying over London. In fact, the last verse was being written as we were flying over London on our way into Heathrow. Just because it says high in it, you know? I mean, high means in the air. I mean, I get vertigo up there, you know. Personally, I hate flying. They were writing the song. It was wonderful. It was a top 10 and blah, blah, blah. And all of a sudden, Spiro Agnew, he was our vice president, you know, at the time. They impeached him for embezzlement and fraud and all that kind of stuff. Yeah, but we were on his top 10 list, along with Puff the Magic Dragon. You'll see Puff the Magic Dragon on every children's album for the last 10 years. I mean, it's on 88 songs for kids. That has absolutely nothing to do with drugs. I mean, 8 miles high, that's, you know, 40-some thousand feet. You know, that's how high we were.
8 miles high, and when you touch down,
you mentioned coming to Britain then, and I remember you coming over here and being on shows like Ready, Steady, Go, and you America's answer to
the BBC. Was that Patty Harrison's show?
Not Patty Harrison, Kathy McGowan.
Kathy McGowan, yeah.
And you were billed as America's answer to the Beatles.
Right.
Did you like that sort of billing?
Well, that was Derek Taylor's doing. All of a sudden you dug that. I didn't agree with it. I mean, personally, there will never be anybody's answer to the Beatles. Just like there will never be anybody's answer to Elvis. There's a lot of Elvis impersonators, but not one of them are going to ever sell that many records or sing that well, I guarantee you. People, you know, believed it or thought that. You know, I thought that was nice, but I never believed it myself.
In the early years in the Byrds, Gene Clark was being remarkably prolific, wasn't he?
He was cranking them out one after the other, yeah. He was unbelievable. You know, and I was sorry when he quit because he was a very important link in the band, as you know, as far as I was concerned. But he just was afraid to fly. You know, he was scared to death of airplanes. We were on our way to New York City and just got up and out the door. He made him open the door. The door had already been closed, and he made him open the door and, you know, left the airplane. It was too bad because, yeah, I loved Gene's songs.
Daytime just makes me feel lonely. At night I can only dream about you. Girl, you're on my mind nearly all of the time. It's so hard being my head keep repeating things that you said when I was with you. And I wonder, is it true? Do you feel the same way too? It's so hard being here without you. There's one thing I'll swear, though you're far away, I'll be thinking about you forever. Streets that I walk on depress me, ones that were happy when I was with you. Friends I know, and with all the things I do, it's so hard being here without you. Being here without you.
I get the impression from David Crosby's autobiography that he was probably something of the sort of troublemaker in the group, so you were perhaps...
Major pain in the ass. I hope I can say that on radio. Who could I relate him to? No one. He was his own troublemaker, you know. He was thrown out of more places. He got us in trouble on the Ed Sullivan Show. He got, you know, everybody wanted to beat him up. I mean, he was just a... He was just a pain in the ass.
Tell us about the trouble on the Ed Sullivan Show.
The trouble. He liked his dirt. I like it too. No problem, I'll tell you. There were trained bears or monkeys or something on, and they needed quiet on the set, and this was all going out live, you know. We're behind the curtain, you know, ready to go on. They needed absolute quiet. I mean, serious quiet. David starts tuning his guitar. You know, just... I mean, bending strings and making a, you know, just loud noises, all kind of loud noises. Well, the producer came back, and he wanted to kill him. He had his hands on him, you know, he grabbed him. He made the producer so mad that when we went on, the producer went up in the booth and turned everything off. This was our debut on American television, okay, with playing Tambourine Man, without any lead guitar, just bass and two vocals. Most god-awful, horrifying experience of sound you've ever heard in your life, I swear. So he sabotaged us, and I don't blame him personally.
Why did you leave the band?
Because I hated all of them.
Well, that's an honest answer.
Because I hated every one of them except Gene and Chris. And no, I'm not so fond of Chris.
What was wrong with Roger McGuinn?
He was always very difficult to get along with. Always thought he was more brilliant than anyone, had this attitude and wouldn't ever speak to anyone. Some kind of prima donna or something. I'm not particularly fond of those type of people.
I'm looking to compete with you, beat or cheat or mistreat you, simplify you, classify you, deny, defy or crucify you. All I really wanna do is maybe be friends with you. No, I ain't looking to fight with you, frighten you or apprise you, drag you down or bring you down, shame you down or bring you down. All I really wanna do be like me. I don't want to meet you again, make you spin or do you in, or select you or dissect you, or inspect you or reject you. All I really wanna do is baby be friends with you. Baby, be friends with you.
You were in the Flying Burrito Brothers.
Mm-hmm.
And did you actually work with Gram Parsons?
Oh, yeah.
And what was he
years.
Like?
He was wonderful. One of my best friends in the world.
Oh, good. Someone you like.
Well, Graham and Chris and I, you know, we all lived together. We were absolute best buddies, you know, poker playing guys together.
Did Graham Parsons introduce people like yourself to country music?
Well, Chris and I had always loved country music. I mean, you know, there's always been that influence in our music. You know, you listen to the bird songs and there's a country twang in there, you know. Unfortunately, you know, Roger is not James Burton. Oh, I'm getting mean now, aren't I?
What did you particularly like about Graham Parsons' talent?
He's intelligent. He's a brilliant man. And he was also carefree. He didn't care what anyone thought. You know, he'd go for it. The ladies loved him. You know, I loved him. I still love him to this day. I cried when he died. One of the very few that I did.
You got a favorite session that you own with him?
I hope you don't play it. It was funny, though. We recorded with Johnny Guitar Watson and Larry Williams. $1,000 wedding? I wish there was such a thing. None of mine ever ended up that cheap. Especially in the end.
What was so special about the session?
Well, Johnny Guitar Watson, you know who he is, right? And Larry Williams, right? Boney Maroney and Short Fat Fanny. We had the pleasure of working with them once. That was the highlight of the evening, you know, playing this stupid slow song, doing the, you know, with them in the booth going, yeah, man, that's the one, that's good. Let's get, that sounded like Wolfman Jack, right? You know, they did. Yeah, that's how Larry Williams talked about this, you know. And it was just hilarious. I mean, that was one of the funniest nights of my life. I remember it well.
Now you're touring with a band that is called The Birds. And of course, people might be coming along expecting to see Roger McGuinn. They might expect to see David Crosby and such like. Really, they're hearing quality songs played by quality musicians.
They're hearing quality songs playing, but much finer. I'll tell you what, I've listened to those two other guys that you just mentioned for years. And the difference between them and these two guys is night and day. Terry and Jerry are unbelievable, and of course Skip is an absolute thrill to be with. We topple houses. I mean, in Germany we were getting 3, 4, or 5 encores a night. Same in Mallorca in Spain, you know. And, I mean, they wouldn't let us off the stage, and same in the U.S. Seriously, those guys, you know, they are wonderful, and they're also wonderful people.
So you're not planning to get back together as the original Bird?
I wouldn't touch it with a 10-foot pole.
Well, Michael Clark, thank you very much.
Was a thousand
1, 2.